Good evening. How's everybody doing this evening? Are we ready to praise the Lord? Are we ready to sing praises to our Lord and Savior? Praise the Lord. I love saying it. I just love it. It's so awesome. Praise God. All right, well, everyone, please stand.
Chains, the world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame when he came for me. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms.
Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, he is for me.
And it was the fire deep in my soul. Never be the same. I stepped out of the dark and into the light when he called my name. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms.
Now, I know it's old, because this is like a hymn, but it's new. You see what I'm saying? I know. How can you, old, new? It is new, though. Amen. Praise the Lord.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful, yeah. the ransom of glory. His face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, I will sing, I will sing, I will sing, yeah.
Exciting night, a lot of things going on around here, and we'll just pray for those things as we enter into this time of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, Lord, and I do pray for the things that have been going on here this evening, Lord, as children's choir started back up this evening, Lord. I pray that you just bless those little kids, Lord, as they pour out their hearts, Lord, and as when they get to come and perform for us, Lord, we just see that that childlike faith. And just displayed in front of us. And Lord, I can't wait for that time as they prepare for those times that they get to come and perform for us, Lord. And I pray that you bless them. Bless Miss Rachel and Ryan as they lead them, Lord. And bless that ministry of our church and our little kids, Lord. And bless the Awana program as it kicks off tonight, Lord. As a bus full of van kids coming in, Lord. It's exciting to know that ministry is still going, and we're bringing in kids from the outside, kids that don't normally go to church, Lord. And I pray specifically for them, Lord. I pray that they would be filled up here and that they would see the love of Jesus Christ just poured out on them. And Lord, all the other Awana kids, Lord, just that if any of them don't know you as Lord and Savior, that tonight, this first night, they would hear the gospel and that they would be saved. And Lord, we pray for this service, the discipleship program that's going on around this building, Lord, just a lot happening. And I pray that you would move in a mighty way in every area. Even move now during this offering. We love you and we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. Stand on mountains.
All right, well, everyone, please stand.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love Him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me, and He's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love Him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me, and He's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. He's a name I love to hear. I love to sing His word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Folks love me. Gives me one whose loving heart can feel. This part gets me. How I love Jesus. above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Emmanuel, God is with us, living word. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Of everything, His name is wonderful. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Sean was breaking down there, and I had a flashback there, brother. When Brother Sean first came to the church, he just had to testify. He, after he had given himself to the Lord and got saved, there'd be times that he used to sit down right here in the front, and he would just say, he'd get up front and he would just say, "He is real. He's real. That's all I can say is He's real." And I'll be honest, it was a little bit of a shocker because, you know, he was out there. He was real, you know. And laugh, cry, or no, it was awesome. It really was. And to see the Lord work in his life and him get involved in ministry and stuff. And again, just the amazing, amazing work there. If you have your Bibles, I ask you to turn to Psalm 75. And, in our lives, I think sometimes we forget that victory is ahead. You know, we got a lot of junk that we deal with in this life, but I was working through this lesson tonight, and that song, the old hymn, came to my mind, and I just want to throw those lyrics up on the screen. Victory ahead, victory ahead. Through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead. Trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread. By faith, I see the victory ahead. And I love that. Again, the trials, the struggles, the frustrations we have in life, circumstances that can overwhelm us in this place right now. Again, whether it's mental, emotional, spiritual things, they can lead to a place of feeling defeated. And sometimes with the failures that we throw on top of all the things that we have to deal with in this life. You know, we got sicknesses, we got, again, the attacks, the struggles, just circumstances, but on top of that, the things that we mess up and the things that are consequences from the things that we mess up. And again, sometimes we can get to a place where we feel absolutely defeated and begin to buy a lot of the enemy's lies and give into that. But I want to encourage us tonight that we have to never forget what our place is, what our role is in this world as an ambassador, number one, but also realizing what an ambassador is. It's somebody who doesn't belong in a place, but they're representing another place. And we're pilgrims, we're sojourners in this land. And so no matter how bad this life gets, no matter how difficult things seem to be in even our own nation one day, no matter what, victory is ahead. We've got a home in glory that outshines the sun. You know, we sing that little song. How many people remember that song? I got a home in glory land that outshines. Yeah, love that song. But that's an amazing reminder that there's nothing too dark in this world, nothing that's so black that can keep us from what's ahead. And again, we have a place of promise in front of us, and so nothing behind us, nothing beside us, even nothing ahead of us, nothing that is in front of our lives that we don't even know. And sometimes we worry about the things that are ahead that we don't even know are going to happen, right? Sometimes we think, well, this is probably going to happen, or this is the way it's going to go. Well, we don't even know that, and sometimes those are the things that discourage us. But I just want to pray, and I want to look into Psalm 75. The psalmist is going to be celebrating anticipated victory. He's going to be praising God for what God is going to do, both in judging the wicked and rewarding the righteous. And I think that's so important. You know, we've seen this theme throughout several of the songs. Psalms. We saw it in chapter 73. Back in chapter 37, we saw it. And so we're going to see it again tonight. And I'll talk about a little more about the things that frustrate and discourage us. And keeping this in mind. So let's pray and we'll get into it. Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for the opportunity, again, to be in your word. Lord, we praise you that we do have victory ahead. Lord, we know that through the cross, through your blood, Lord, through you overcoming, we are overcomers in Christ. And so, Lord, we thank you so much that no matter what we face in this life, the difficulties, the circumstances, the trials, the struggles, Lord, even in our own weaknesses and our own failures that we experience, Lord, one day we're going to enter into that place. We're going to enter into your presence. And the light there is going to outshine the sun. Lord, we are looking forward to that day. We're not only looking forward to that day to be in your presence and to receive the reward of being your children and running a faithful race, God, but we don't seek vengeance. We don't desire to execute things that or against the wicked, Lord, but we know, and part of our faith, part of our assurance, part of our comfort in this life is that wickedness, that the wicked aren't forever going to continue in that wickedness. Or one day there's going to be a judgment, and it's going to be right. And so, Lord, I praise you for that, and I thank you for that. And tonight, just have your way in our lives through this time. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 75, we're just going to jump into verse 1. It says, unto thee, O God, do we give thanks. Unto thee do we give thanks. For that thy name is near, thy wondrous works declare. That's beautiful to me. I love that verse right there. We give thanks because your name is near to us. We can just say Father. We can just say Lord. We can just say Jesus. Your name is near. We're not far from even your name. And not only that, but speaking his name declares his wondrous works. Not only that, declaring his wondrous works points back to his name. Again, you can't separate God from the great things that he's done. And that's what the psalmist is celebrating this. And I believe that's why we should praise him. And all of our thanks, all of our praise for anything good, anything great, should be directed towards him. Not just in our hearts, but very clearly with our lips. And you know, I've preached on this before, and I want to make sure that's understood. God sees the heart, the Bible says, and God's concerned about the heart. But he's concerned about the heart in regards to sincerity. That's important. It doesn't mean that, so I just have my own way of praising God. Well, yeah, you're unique, you're special, absolutely. But there's something to say about our lips, our mouth, if we have ability to, that God has blessed us with, to speak things with, to say things with. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So he's given us these lips, he's given us this mouth to give him thanks, to give him praise. Jesus said, tell them to be quiet. He says, if they don't give praise, then the rocks cry out in praise. You know, so we have the ability with our mouths to praise and declare the wonderful works of God. Again, not just in our hearts, but with our lips. I remember being a teenager, and that was my excuse because of pride, because of not wanting someone else to hear me and think, oh man, what is that kid doing? You know, what kind of noises are he making back there, you know? But it was about me. I wasn't focusing my attention solely on God. I wasn't focusing my thoughts and my heart directly on God. I was thinking about me. I was thinking about others. And so it was hard for my lips, it was hard for my mouth to utter the praises, the songs of thanks and praise, because I was concerned about something else. And so, again, we see here, saying, listen, I'm going to praise you. Let's declare this. We give thanks to God because of the great things he's done. Again, not just with our hearts, but even with our mouths. I love the imagery that's given in Psalm 119, 103. It says, "How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth." You know, to read the word of God and to speak it out loud, the psalmist was saying, man, just saying the words of God, the things that God has written down, they're like honey in my mouth. To speak the great word of God, to call out his name, it's such an amazing blessing. There's an old chorus that we used to do back in the youth, and it was called Holy and Anointed One. And I used to love doing that song. Just a little chorus, just a small little song. And I got just the verse and a chorus, and I want you to look at it. The song used to go, Jesus, Jesus, Holy and Anointed One, Jesus. Your name is like honey on my lips, your spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp to my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you. Again, just the thought of his name being on our lips. Being able to say, again, Father, Lord, Savior, Jesus. When we sing that song, Jesus, Jesus, there's just something about that name. And I'll be honest with you, I've shared this stuff with you before. I was raised in church, and again, when I was a teenager, we used to sing songs, and I've shared this about the blood and the cross, and I used to be like, I know I should be more moved by the blood. I know I should be more moved by the cross, but I just, at that point in time, I wasn't understanding. It wouldn't hit me like it should. Well, the same thing about songs like that. Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name, you know. And it's the same thing. I used to think, man, it is a good name, you know. It's my Savior's name. But it wasn't impacting me like it does today. It wasn't just the thought of, what a beautiful name, what a powerful name, what an amazing name, what a humbling privilege to be able to say the name of Jesus. And the cool thing about it is this, when I call his name, he says, yes, my child. That's mind-blowing, you know. That blows my mind that we call his name, he listens, he hears. His wondrous works, his powerful name, his glorious presence, promises that are ahead, all deserve praise from our hearts. All deserve praise not only from our hearts, but from our lips. Psalms 34, verse 1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise, listen to this, shall continually be in my mouth. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You know, I at one point in time, I was doing youth ministry and leading music and singing and stuff. But from the very beginning of being in ministry, when I got involved in that, I felt, and I still do, but I had just absolute feeling of unworthiness. I knew, because I had a plan that was going this way, and God called me and said, you're going to go this way, you know, shut all the doors over here and said, you're going to follow me, you're going to do what I want you to do. And when I surrendered, I was like, that is, who am I? You know, that's not even in my plan. That's not, what am I going to do? And so right from the beginning, it was just in my mind, it's been in my heart, that anything that I can do, whether it's song, whether it's message, teach, help, count, whatever, it's always been in my mind, praise God. Praise God. And so early on, people used to ask, why do you say praise God? Because that was in my heart. And I'm not trying to sound pious or like super spiritual or anything like that, but honestly, I really feel like he deserves the praise. I realize who I am. I know what I've done. And I don't deserve the praise for anything good. I don't deserve the glory for anything that can be done for God's kingdom, for God's glory, for his people to work in anybody's life. If I'm simply used as a vessel in any way, he deserves the praise. I'm just the vessel. And so again, when I think of this verse, his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Not just who he is, but what he does in our life and what he allows us to do. You know, we're talking about this morning, just being consumed day by day with the thoughts. And not only that, but disturbed with our sleep at night of those sin-sick, you know, souls that are crying out, bring me to Jesus. Bring me to Jesus. He allows us the opportunity, as I said in the beginning, to be an ambassador. Not only are we unworthy to speak his name, we're unworthy to carry his banner and bring others to him, to share him with others. Such an unworthy thing. So again, he deserves all the praise. Psalm 63, verse 3, it says, because thy loving kindness, love this verse too, because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness. And my mouth, not just my heart, my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips when I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches. Beautiful. I love it. I love these verses of saying God deserves our praise. God is worthy of our praise. Every moment of our life, he deserves to have his name and his praise coming out of our mouths. Not just in vain repetition, not just in vain efforts or vain showing in a church service. And I'm not saying that you do that. That's not what God expects. You can praise him in the congregation of saints. You can praise him in the private prayer chamber. But God wants it to come out. And it's not to say that you can't praise him in your heart out of sincerity and God hears it, just like you can pray in your heart in sincerity and God hears it. But there's something about using the vessels of praise, the instruments of voice, to give him praise that's so important. Psalms 109 verse 30 says, I will greatly praise the Lord with my mouth. I will greatly praise the Lord with my mouth. Yea, I will praise him among the multitude. Again, so important for us to get this great privilege of praising God every day of our life, every moment of our life, having that. You know, sometimes, said before, whenever you like hit your thumb on a, you know, with a, not hit your thumb, hit a hammer on your thumb. You know, hit your thumb on a hammer, and, no, but hit your thumb with a hammer. Or, you know, slam it in a door or whatever. Hit it, get hurt. Praise the Lord. It's better than saying some other things. You know? I'm not saying that's something to praise the Lord for, but maybe so. Well, let's look on it. Verse 2 back in our text, it says, when I shall receive the congregation, I will judge uprightly. The earth and all the inhabitants thereof are dissolved. I bear up the pillars of it. Salah. As I said earlier, one of the great works of God, it's his righteous judgment. Now, so many in our world today, you talk to them, and that's what they say. Well, I don't think God's going to judge me like that. Or they think that God is judgmental, and God is this angry God looking to pour out mean things in good people's lives. But so many people look at God's judgment as a bad thing. They see it as this is only a negative thing. But I want to say this. You and I can have confidence. We can have joy. We can praise him in his judgment because of this. Number one and most important thing. God's judgment is going to be perfect. It is, and it's going to be, at the judgment, perfectly just. Perfectly just. And you say, well, why is that so important? Why is that such a thing to praise God about? Because, you know, we could sit around this room and we could throw out scenarios. We could present different court cases and different things that people have done, and there's no doubt there would be varied thought processes and various judgments that people would have based on their experience in their life, based on the mercy they've received in their life, based on the things they know they've done and maybe got away with, and we look at these cases, and no doubt in man's judgment, we would come to different conclusions. Some of us maybe would be exactly alike. Some of us would be one group, and maybe it would be two large groups or whatever. But there's no doubt there would be varying thoughts of what should happen to the people. What I rest in and what I have peace with and what makes me excited about the judgment of God is that everything that he decides on that day of judgment is going to be perfectly right, perfectly fair. And again, in our minds, in our human minds, you know, you witness to somebody say, you know, stand before God one day, if you haven't accepted Christ, if you haven't taken his sacrifice, haven't surrendered your life to him, haven't been born again, If you stand before him on that day and you haven't made that decision, you're not a child of God, then he's going to, in his judgment, turn you away and going to send you to a place that was reserved for Satan and his demons. And again, in the man's judgment, they say, how is it fair to receive that same exact judgment for all of eternity as a person who was a good worker at his job, a good husband to his wife and father to his kids and took care of his home and gave to charity and even went to church every now and then? I mean, how can that person spend eternity in the same place as the person who was committing perverse and vile acts, breaking the law in so many different ways and injuring and hurting and destroying, maybe even murdering, serial murder people. I mean, how can that person spend eternity in the same place as that person? And what gives me freedom, what gives me peace is this: I'm not God. And he is perfectly right and just. And I can rest that even if the things that don't make sense in our minds are accomplished on that day of judgment, it's right. It's right and it's just. Again, I could, in man's judgment, I could argue, well, this person that abuses women and children and murders and does these things, and then you got this outstanding person that we painted the picture of a while ago, in my human mind, I'm thinking, send them to a further, deeper part of hell, you know? And maybe so. But God is perfectly just. And so, praising him for his judgment, again, not according to man's judgments, not according to man's standards. And here's the deal, too, with that. Our judgment is tainted with sin. We're tainted in the sin that we've experienced, the fleshly bodies that we're walking around in. Our judgment, even if we think that we are righteous and we are right and our judgment is good, we're still tainted. God is perfectly just. He's perfectly right in all of his judgment. And he's going to judge according to his judgment, according to his justice, and according to his holiness. Here's the amazing thing about his judgment as well. It's such a great judgment. It's such a powerful judgment that the earth quakes. The earth quakes. Yet while it quakes at his judgment, while the power contained in his judgment shakes the earth, he has the power to sustain it. Amazing, and that's what he was saying. But look on in verse 4. He says, I said to the fools, deal not foolishly. And to the wicked, lift not up the horn. Lift not up your horn on high. Speak not with a stiff neck. For promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south. Clearly here, God is warning the wicked. He's telling them, here's some warnings and here's some instruction. Not only for the wicked, but specifically for those who are wicked, who are foolish in pride. Proud individuals lifting themselves up. He says, here, change your heart towards me. Change your attitude towards me. You have a wrong heart towards me. And the metaphor that's used is one of an animal. He says, you know, this animal that lifts it on high. He says, don't do that. You know, if you see in the animal world, whenever they become lifted up in attack mode or lifted up in confidence, you know, like turkeys, you know what turkeys do whenever they start getting around like the males, and they start getting around the females, and they start feeling a little confident, want those females to notice them. You know what they do, right? You know, they puff themselves up, and that tail feather goes up. They start strutting around that thing, and they're making themselves big. They're puffing themselves up. Hey, look at me. You want this turkey, you know? That's what they're saying to that decoy there, you know? Can you see that tail feather back there, sister? You know? That's what they're doing. Let that soak in for a second. But again, it's a metaphor here of defiance. And basically in the threat in the face of an adversary, they're puffing themselves up. And so God's the fool sees God in that same exact way as an adversary. You know, you talk to, again, somebody who's lost, somebody who is ignorant according to salvation, ignorant according to God's love and his judgment. And that's how they see God, as I said a while ago. Well, he's a mean God. He's an angry God. He's a judgmental God. And again, because they're at enmity with him. The lost soul is at enmity with him. But again, to see him and to lift up themselves in pride. The arrogance to say, you know what? I don't need God. I don't need anything of him. He's not all that. Again, it's a show of rebellion against him. And that type of foolish pride, that type of arrogance, that type of defiance is rendering someone helpless from any direction. And that's what he said. Promotion doesn't come from the east, it doesn't come from the west. You lift yourself up like that, wicked person. You lift yourself up like that animal defying in the face of an adversary. You are without help. There's no help for you. And the Bible talks about there's no help for a fool. It's foolish for the lost to do so. It's foolish for anybody to lift themselves up in pride against God. And it begs the question for me is this. How foolish then is it for the child of God to lift themselves up in pride against God? To lift themselves up in arrogance against God? That's why I don't do that. Maybe we do it more than we think. Maybe we lift ourselves up in selfish pride more than we think against God. In our minds, we don't want to think that we have that attitude towards God. But maybe it's not in our minds directly to God. Maybe it's to God's word or his will or his work. Maybe that's where we lift ourselves up. That is, I don't have to, that's not for, I don't believe that like that. Again, sometimes we lift ourselves up in pride against God by lifting up ourselves in pride against God's stuff, his word, his will, his way, his leaders, his church. Stuff. Sometimes that's what we do, and we think, well, I don't think that's the same thing. Again, we often make these decisions based on our own judgment, but we could go through scripture after scripture to prove it's the same type of pride against God. Same type of pride. Look on verse 7, it says, but God is the judge. He putteth down one, and he setteth up another. For in the hand of the Lord there is a cup, and the wine is red, and it's full of mixture. And he poureth out of the same, but the dregs thereof, all the wicked of the earth shall wring them out and drink them. Another metaphor here in this chapter, and it's a sad, but it's a true, but again, it brings comfort of this unrelenting wrath of God that's going to be poured out, basically like a foaming wine, he's saying. This is the way that God's going to pour out his wrath. It's like a cup of wine, and all the foolish, all the wicked of the earth, the arrogant, the unrepentant sinners in the earth will one day drink the wine of the wrath of God. And it's not just going to be a partial wrath. It's not just going to be part of God's wrath. As I said a while ago, when we think in our mind, well, they don't deserve that type of judgment like that person does. No. The Bible says it's going to be like a full cup of wine. And it's not just that, but the little settlings, the dregs, the settlings that go down to the bottom of the cup, they're going to be wrung out too, and that's going to be it. The full force of the wrath of God poured out in judgment against the wicked. Now, back to the wondrous works of God. Back to God in his wonder. This power that he has to this wrath that's going to be poured out, to give us a little better perspective, this wrath is going to be poured out on the wicked, and all this power, just his words, just his mouth, just the things that he says in his judgment, again, has so much power. The Bible says this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3, through faith we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. They were created. They were brought into being by the words of God. He spoke them, and such power was in his words that the worlds were formed that way. Psalms 33:6 says, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made. And I love this verse right here, the second part of it. And all the hosts, talking about the stars, all the hosts of them, by the breath of his mouth, he breathed out the stars. That's phenomenal. What imagery, what an amazing picture that Scripture gives us of the power of God's word, the power of God's spoken judgment. Let it be. Let there be light. Boom. And there's light. Such power contained in God. And the same power is going to be realized in his wrath poured out against wickedness. That same power, that same power that shakes the world, that breathes out the stars, that it speaks creation into existence, is going to be experienced in his wrath. But here's the deal. It's not because he desires to destroy. It's not that God's looking to get, well, I'm just looking out to who I can destroy. I can't wait one day that all these people are, I don't think it makes Jesus happy, the fact that he said there's few on the path that leads to life everlasting and there's many on the broad road that leads to destruction. I don't think that makes Jesus happy. It's the truth. He knows that's the truth because the cost of discipleship, the cost of following Jesus Christ. But again, it's not because he desires to destroy. Remember, he's the author of life. He values life so much that he was willing to send his own son to give life for every unrighteous person. But here's the deal. It's because of his holiness and his justice. It will not and he cannot ultimately and eternally allow for any unrighteousness, any sin, any wickedness. That's the reason why the powerful, full wrath of God is going to be poured out against wickedness. So let's think of it like this. When we look at all the tormenting that's going on, you know, I got an email this morning from one of the family groups or something, and it just caught my attention because it seems like we saw this home movie on Elizabeth Smart. Y'all remember that name, Elizabeth Smart? So the girl that got abducted when she was 14 years old and was spent like 9 months, like in Utah, and by this person who thought he was a prophet of God. He called himself like Emmanuel or whatever, and this lady. And anyways, a bicycler spotted them at one point in time, and they ended up rescuing her. But I was reading, because she's now like an advocate. She's even like one of the people that contribute to news people. Consultant or whatever, for ABC News, and she was talking about some of the horrors, and I didn't read it, I didn't listen to it, but the main thing was about pornography, what this man made her do, and I didn't want to watch it, I didn't want to know everything, but just that thought and kind of that part about it. It just began to make me sick to my stomach just to think, 14-year-old girl, you know, this 50-something-year-old man. Yeah, I mean, the age doesn't matter, but I'm just saying, it's just, I say that to say, it's just absolutely sick that there's tormenting, there is despicable, there's just absolute vile, wicked things in people in this world. And we think of all these things, these absolute desolate acts that are done all around the world. You know, there's videos that you see over in the Middle East and they're, you know, of kids and ISIS chopping heads off. And you think, how in the world can someone be that vile and that wicked? How can someone be so debased? I can't fathom in my mind. I don't know about you, but for me, it's hard for me not to want something done now, right? I'm thinking, Elizabeth Smart's dad, I just don't even know. I just plead the mercy of God and the grace of God. Nothing like that ever comes. Because I'm just saying, like, I want to be like Jesus, but that might be the thing that turns me, you know? And I'm just speaking as a man. I'm not trying to pretend to be more holy. I'm just saying, you talk about messing with little ones, you talk about doing that kind of stuff, and Lord help me. It's hard not to want that. It's hard not to want justice and judgment to be poured out right now. And I think that's what we see even in courtrooms sometimes when people get the justice that comes to them in this world through the court system. And you see families breaking down in tears and hugging each other after a judgment is passed on someone who's committed a crime. And they see the joy that comes through that judgment. Again, that's the way that we have, that's the way that we're wired when we consider all the wickedness and the vileness and all this evil in the world. And again, it's hard not to want that justice and that judgment right now when we see those things done. It's hard not to. Especially when you know there's things that are being done that aren't, you know, in our minds, they're not being brought to justice. That's not fair. That's not right. Rest assured, something is already done. Something's already determined. Something's already decreed and declared. As far as the judgment against wickedness, it's already their fate is already sealed unless they turn. So no matter how bad it is, again, in our minds, in our human reasoning, we think, well, if this person's that vile, this person's not that vile, and they go to the same place again, God's judgment and his justice is perfect. You know, he died on a cross, not just for those who would commit murder. And he says, thou shalt not murder. You know, don't kill each other with malice. Don't do that. But he also says, thou shalt not bear false witness. Don't lie. Because all liars have their part in the lake of fire. It's an offense against God, against a holy and righteous God. So again, that judgment is already determined. They're already going to pay for what they're going to get. And it's going to be that full wrath of God against them. It's going to be the full power. Again, the spoken word of God. When he speaks their judgment, when he says, depart from me and into everlasting fire. When he says those words, it's going to shake them for all of eternity as they're tormented. Day and night without relief. That's a judgment for all of eternity. That's a judgment that you and I could never impose upon anybody on this earth. That nothing in this world could impose upon. That judgment is going to be the full wrath of God. But the amazing thing is this. The amazing thing is that all of that power, all of that wrath against unrighteousness, all of it, the fierceness of the wrath of God against all unrighteousness was poured out on Christ. Was poured out on Jesus Christ in our behalf, in our place. What the vilest of sinners deserve, what the people who are tormenting and in perversion, all those things, all of that wrath against that unrighteousness, 2,000 years ago, God poured it out on his own son for us. What the vilest deserved, he poured out on Christ. Fullness of the wrath of God. That's mind-blowing. Again, in our place. So as those who are righteous in Christ, if you're here tonight and you've been born again and you are righteous in Christ, we can say as the psalmist said in the next verse, in verse 9, but I will declare forever. I will sing praises to the God of Jacob. All the horns of the wicked also will I cut off. But the horns of the righteous shall be exalted. Judgment and wrath upon those who reject Christ's sacrifice in this age. At this point in time, judgment and wrath upon them. But victory is ahead for all who have accepted him. Victory ahead. Victory ahead. Again, that's the psalmist praising him. No matter what the wicked is doing, no matter what judgment is deserved, no matter what judgment is, no matter what, there's victory ahead for those who are the righteous in Christ. And tonight I want to encourage you. Let's make sure that we are keeping our eyes focused on him. Let's make sure that his praise is always on our lips. Let's make sure that we're always focusing our lives on him and not on what we think people should get. You know, we're going to have opinions. We're going to have that in our life. We're going to see these things. We're going to have the even right feelings and right judgments according to God. But let's keep our focus on him and what he's already determined. We have a home in glory land. That judgment that's coming one day is going to be right and just. That should keep us driven. That should keep us in full praise to Him every day of our life. Tonight I want to ask our ushers to come and we'll spend a few minutes in prayer together, and then we'll open up the altar. And maybe tonight, I know for me, thinking about the wrath of God poured out on Jesus Christ on my behalf is a humbling thing. I want to encourage you tonight, if you don't pray over a prayer request at the altar, maybe just come down and say, God, I just want to praise you. I want to start tonight by praising you for taking my wrath upon my Savior. I want to praise you. I want to be every day of my life praising you for what you've done. You notice on your prayer list as you're getting them, some of the same things that we've been praying for. We just want to be faithful to pray for these things. One of the things under state issues, we've been praying for our school districts and schools. But school has started for many people, many kids, many families. I want to keep them in prayer. School is about to start for others. Again, the same prayers for the protection to be lights there. And just remember, we have at the bottom, pray for a blessed fall season. So many things coming up. All of our you know, not all of our, but a lot of our ministries kick off with women's ministry, men's ministry. We've got the Institute starting. Several different things going on. So we just want to pray for God's hand to be on that. And I just want to say there's something that, and I always want to share, like, God, when he answers prayers and he's moving. We've been praying under our church, pray for God's will in a new building project, and we just recently added finances. And there have been a couple of doors potentially open where God is blessing in that area. I don't know anything. There's nothing definite for sure, but it's just amazing, and I want to share that. That's amazing. We just last week, I'm not joking, we added that to this part of the prayer, and last week, from Monday to Friday, there were two things, two opportunities that came to me, like not me going and seeking, that came to me that could potentially be financially blessing to the building. And so God answers prayers. God's hearing our prayers. And so I want to continue praying for the right things according to His will. So I appreciate you, God, doing that. Groups of two or three, and we'll take about 10 minutes or so in this, and then we'll open up for individual prayers. So let's pray.